Many times we're sitting there and we're running from the devil, fussing about the devil, talking about the devil, when we're supposed to be magnifying the Lord. You know, when you're grateful and you're thankful to the Lord, you're positioning yourself, and the law of attraction is bringing those things that you want, not the wrong thing. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 6. As you have therefore received Christ, Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk you in Him, rooted and built up in Him and established in the faith. Notice it says, as you have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. So in other words, they were taught to abound in thanksgiving, to abound in faith by our thanksgiving. Thanksgiving to God. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments or principles of this world, and not after Christ. For in Him, Jesus, dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete, you are whole in Him, which is the head of all principality and power. Glory to God. God, Jesus, come on, second person of the Trinity, glory be to God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. He paid the whole price. He's done it all. Everything that you could ever need was purchased at the cross through the blood of Jesus Christ. And so we acknowledge that and we are grateful. And in everything that we need in life that we put our faith to, we put our faith to it believing, and believing with thanksgiving. You know, when you give thanks, you are believing that God not only is going to do something, but, you know, after He does it, we're grateful that He did it. Come on. Amen. We've got to be grateful people. We've got to, you know, when you take your eyes and your focus off yourself and you put the focus on Jesus, then you are positioned right for your miracle. Many times we're focused on the problem. We're focused on the disease, the sickness, the thing, the finances, whatever it might be. And instead of focused on the One who has already delivered us, has already paid for the answer, who has already blessed us, who's already did everything, He went to the cross for you and He paid the price. And when you realize He paid the price, then you have a reason to thank Him. You have a reason to jump up and down when you really have a revelation that He's done everything. Hallelujah. He's done everything. And you have been made whole. You know, when I look at this and it says, after the rudiments of men, after the traditions of men, and people following the traditions of men. And, you know, we don't believe that miracles are for today. You know, miracles went out with the 12 apostles. You know, if people come up to me and they say, well, you know, miracles went out with the 12 apostles. I said, well, what number was Paul?
There you go.
Well, Paul wasn't one of the 12. Come on, somebody. I mean, they taught their disciples. They taught everybody. How many know you get the book of Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, all these books, all these letters were to the churches to teach them how to move in the things of God. These signs shall follow those that believe.
Yes.
They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Well, if you really believe that, then you know, if you're a believer, how many believers we have here today?
Amen.
Well, if you're a believer, then you're going to lay hands on somebody. Hallelujah. You say, well, what are you talking about laying hands? Well, you know, God said, when you touch somebody, that anointing that's on you, get on them. How many know if you want that healing anointing that's in you, it'll be transferred into them? Glory to God. You pray for that healing anointing. You pray for those things. You are anointed. Come on.
Hallelujah.
You know the word Christian means anointed?
Yes.
You're anointed. Hallelujah. With what? The presence of God. The glory of God. The anointing of God. And you take that anointing, you just let that anointing flow out of you, and you take that anointing and you just love on somebody. Well, believers will lay hands on the sick. It's not just for the 12. It's not just the traditions of men it's talking about here. It's saying that when we really get a hold of faith, we're going to have thanksgiving to God, because now we are all moving into a place of complete or wholeness, where we are just as if Adam never sinned, redeemed of the curse, blessed going in, blessed going out. Come on. Hallelujah. Don't listen to the doubters and the unbelievers. I mean, just begin to say, thank you, Lord, that you're good. Thank you, Lord, that you're good. Thank you that your word is true. Thank you, Lord God, that I can believe your word, I can stand on your word, and you are faithful. Hallelujah. Turn with me to Proverbs chapter 23. Hallelujah. Not the 23rd Psalm, but the 23rd Proverb. Hallelujah. Proverbs chapter 23. And let's go down to verse 7. Thank you, Jesus. For as he thinks in his heart, so is he. As a man thinks in his heart, as a woman thinks in their heart, so is, you know, so are they. Hallelujah. If you are believing and thinking a certain way, focusing on certain things, if you focus on God, then you are moving towards a miracle. If you're focused on the sickness, you're moving in the sickness. Are you hearing what I'm saying? As you think in your heart, what you're focused on matters. What you focus on in your heart. Everybody say, in your heart. In your heart. That's what you attract. This is called the law of attraction. My goodness, if you focus on someone that's done wrong to you, bitterness and envy and all kinds of things begin to get in your heart. Well, if you allow those things to get in your heart, they begin to be your focus, and that's who you become. I don't know about you, but I want to get God in my heart. Amen. I want to become like Him. I want to be a child of the King. I want to look like Him, talk like Him, and that's the goal. I want to be like Jesus. Hallelujah. How about you? Glory be to God. When we walk like Him, talk like Him, we get right. Oh, we just rise up in Jesus. We are going to be like Him. Whatever you focus on. I don't want to focus on the problem, because that's what's magnified in my life. I want to magnify the Lord. Amen. Come on. Glory be to God. I want to magnify the Lord. I remember one time the Lord said to me, "Why are you magnifying the devil?" I said, "I wouldn't magnify the devil." He said, "Why are you magnifying the devil?" I said, I don't magnify. I magnify the Lord. He said, "Then why do you always talk about the devil and how he's done this and he's done that? And I told you not to give him any place." Many times we're sitting there and we're running from the devil, fussing about the devil, talking about the devil, when we're supposed to be magnifying the Lord. Amen. You know, when you're grateful and you're thankful to the Lord, you're positioning yourself, and the law of attraction is bringing those things that you want, not the wrong thing. Amen. We need to start speaking the right thing to get the right thing. Start positioning ourselves for those things that we want in our lives. God wants good things in your life. God wants you to move forward and not backwards. If you focus on God, you attract miracles. If you focus on sickness, you attract sickness. I hear people all the time. You get around elderly people. I was at my dad's. You know, it was a senior living, but it was senior. You know, he lived on a golf course. They all had their own homes. And it was basically, if you're over 55, you could live there. And they just didn't want any kids messing up the golf course. And, you know, and people would be out there saying, "Get off my lawn!" You know. And so they're out there and they're, but they're always talking about sickness. I mean, that's all they do. They just, I mean, I got there and I wanted to get out of there. They just, oh yeah, yeah, how you doing? Well, you know, that arthritis, we're acting up, you know. It's like the very first thing that come out of their mouths, you don't want to ask how they're doing. You want to tell them how they're doing, glory to God. But they're just fussing, and so you ask one guy, you doing all right? Well, I forgot to take my memory pills this morning. And they laugh about it, but how many know you're attracting the wrong thing? As you think in your heart, so are you. As you think in your heart, that's the way it's going to be. As you think differently, you're going to, you know, if you think this way, I'm grateful to God. I magnify the Lord. I thank you, Jesus, that you paid the price. I thank you, Jesus, that by your stripes I am healed. I was healed 2,000 years ago.
Hallelujah.
Turn me over here to... Proverbs chapter 14. Go down to 14. Proverbs 14 and verse 30. A sound heart, how many know, as you think in your heart, that's how you'll be. A sound heart is life, life of the flesh. It is the life of the flesh. But envy, and that word envy there is also the word bitterness. Envy and bitterness is rottenness to the bones. When you walk in bitterness, you walk in unforgiveness, you walk in all those things, you are literally causing sickness in your body. Science has proven that. Science looks at the Bible and says, what else do we want to investigate here? And they find out that, yeah, that's true. I mean, they get over there and they find out that people who stay bitter, stay with unforgiveness in their heart, then they tend to, you know, get worse. But those that walk in forgiveness, and they begin to forgive those that have hurt them, those that have sinned against them, those that have trespassed against them, they begin to get better. Why? Because they're not bringing that junk into their bones. They're not bringing it into their body. They're not letting that just... You ever hear people say something like this? Well, that's just been eating me. Yeah, literally. Literally. What they did just been eating me. Just eating me. Eating me up. I just can't believe they did that to me. Well, you better stop that confession because it is eating you up. Not only spiritually, but physically. And it'll continue to do that and continue to do that because all you're doing is allowing that junk to sit in there and stew. God learned that lesson. What? Yeah, God learned that lesson. He said, my mercies are new every morning. You know why? He don't want it to stew. I mean, he said, oh, I was ready to blow up the world. I mean, you look down at with the children of Israel out there in the wilderness. I mean, he's like... There's so many times throughout Scripture where God had just had it. Aren't you glad he's also love? And aren't you glad for his mercy? Amen. Amen. And that's why he got over into that, you know, he said, my mercies are new every morning. I'll give you a clean slate. Rise up and win. Hallelujah. And he doesn't let it stew himself. He doesn't let it go. How much more should we, when we are offended, not allow a day to go by where we don't just immediately say, I forgive them. And maybe they did you real wrong, but it's better to forgive them than to let what they did cause you to have a problem.
Absolutely.
See, it's not really hurting them. Half the time, they don't even know what they did. They're just like, well, I'm just thinking about myself. They don't even know what they're doing. But how many know that if you just continue in that hurt and that pain and that mess, then it will affect you, not them.
Amen.
So you got to get to a point where you say, you know what? I'm not going to allow that to have any effect on my health. I'm not going to allow that to come against me. I forgive them. And you know what forgive means? It doesn't mean forget. You don't forget. You're not, you know, you don't get amnesia. No, you don't forget, but you choose by an act of your will to forgive, and then with time, you don't focus on it anymore.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So you don't want things eating at you. Say,
I don't want
anything
eating at me.
Turn with me to Luke chapter 17. Luke chapter 17. Thank you, Jesus. Let's go down here to verse 11. And it came to pass, as Jesus went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. The reason they stood afar off was because they weren't allowed to go into the town, and they weren't allowed to go too close to anybody, because leprosy is very contagious. And they weren't even allowed to go into the town. They had to go off into other, you know, leper colonies and places where they could just live somewhere else. And what they had was a flesh-eating disease where it was really eating at them. Now, how many know sometimes God uses certain things in the Word of God to show us certain things in the Spirit to show us things in the natural, and things in the natural to show us things in the Spirit? They've proven that it's more than just flesh-eating disease. It's actually their nerves stop working. And so when they get a sore or something, they don't know it. And it just begins to eat their flesh. So there's more to all that. Sometimes we get to a place where we're numb and we don't feel things anymore, but they're still working at us subconsciously. If we don't forgive, if we don't lay it down, if we don't put it under the blood, if we just think we're fine, but we keep carrying it. God wants us to be healed. God wants us to be whole. God wants us to walk in His anointing. God wants us to be free. Come on, somebody. He gave us His Word, and His Word is life, and we have a lot to be thankful for.
Amen.
Hallelujah. They couldn't go into town. They couldn't even get close to Jesus here. Now, it says, and they stood afar off. Verse 13. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus. Do you know why they lifted up their voices? Because they couldn't get too close. Jesus, Master, Rabbi, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said to them, go show yourselves to the priest. Well, the only reason you would show yourself to the priest is when you're finally, if for some reason you got healed of this disease, then you could go to the priest, and the priest would say, you're clean. And once you're clean, you can enter the city.
Right.
Up to that point, you're unclean. The priest can, he is the only one that can say over you that you're clean. And so Jesus says, now look at this. Jesus says, go show yourselves to the priest. And it came to pass that as they went, everybody say, as they went,
as they went,
they were cleansed. As they went, they were cleansed. How many know that they weren't healed yet when they turned around and started walking towards the priest?
That's right.
I mean, that's an act of faith.
Yeah.
They believed Jesus that if they would go, just move, do something, that they would be cleansed. And so as they went, they were cleansed. Are you seeing that?
Yes.
That's faith. That's faith. As they went, they were cleansed. Glory be to God. So They just believed God. They believed Jesus. They said, you know, if He told us to do it, when we get there, it's going to be okay. As they went, they were cleansed. Hallelujah. And one of them, everybody say one. How many know there was ten? And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned around, turned back, and with a loud voice glorified God and fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. Now, the others didn't do that.
No.
They just kept going. We don't want us hang around here very long because we want to make sure when we get to that priest, he says we're unclean. I mean, we're clean now. We're clean and we can go into the town. We can live like normal people. But one thought it was necessary to turn around and with gratitude and thanksgiving, thank the Lord for what he did. Hallelujah. It's a great thing what he did, but it's sad the others didn't do that. But you know, a lot of people are that way. A lot of people are really, they're focused on what they want instead of focused on thanking the Lord for it. And so here, he stops and he thanks God. Everybody say, he thanked God. It says, giving him thanks, and he was a Samaritan. He's not even a Jew. But he knows what to do here. He knows what's right. And Jesus answering said, were there not ten cleansed? Well, where are the nine? Where are they? Well, how come they didn't come out back and thank me? Where are the nine? There are not found that returned. There are not found that returned to give glory to God, save this stranger, the Samaritan. And he said to him, "Arise, go your way. Your faith," I say, faith, "has made you whole."
Hallelujah.
Now, the nine got cleansed. The nine still had scars. The nine were healed. I mean, sometimes when you get healed, you still have scars. But this one that came back was made whole. If he didn't have an arm, it came out. If his nose was half eaten, it came back. I mean, you couldn't recognize the guy. When he came back, there's something about gratitude that will bring you into a place of being complete, a place of abounding in your faith, a place where you become whole.
Amen.
I don't want the scars. I don't want to see all that mess. I want all of it. Come on. I want to be made whole. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, it's one thing to have divine health, but there's another thing. One person says, I want a healing. Well, healing's good. But divine health is a whole lot better.
Amen.
Wholeness is a whole lot better. Soteria, salvation, that's the word soteria in the Greek, means wholeness. Shalom, peace, means wholeness. We're talking about the fullness of the blessing is wholeness. Nine of them didn't get the fullness of the blessing. Nine of them people will always look to those nine and say they were lepers. But that tenth one, when people see him, they'll say, "Now who are you? Good to meet you. I'm glad you're here. Come on, we like people like you." I'm sure he is treated completely differently. Why? Because now he was completely restored. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory be to God. You know, thanksgiving is honoring God. I want to honor God.
Amen.
You look at this Samaritan, he honored Jesus. I want to honor the Lord. You know, that's reverence. Reverence is a part of thanksgiving. Reverence is the beginning of wisdom. Reverence is when we begin to know. Gratitude and thanksgiving is when we really understand honoring God, worshiping God, giving him the praise. You know, when Jesus went into his own hometown of Nazareth, he couldn't even do but a few miracles because they didn't honor him.
Right.
They said, isn't this the one, the carpenter's son? Isn't this that construction worker? isn't he just, and they looked to the natural. And Jesus had to go on because they didn't honor him, so there couldn't be very many miracles. When we honor God, we have lots of miracles in our life. When we honor God, when we give Him glory, when we are grateful, we are receiving His miraculous power. We're receiving Him. We're attracting Him into our lives. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Turn with me over here to Proverbs 17. Let's go back to Proverbs. Proverbs 17. We're already in 17, but we're going to go down a little ways. Proverbs 17 and verse 22. It says, a merry heart, you know that merry? Literally means grateful, gladness, joyful. How many know you're to rejoice in the Lord? Amen. In the Lord. A merry heart does good like a medicine, but a broken spirit dries the bones. Here we see it again. It's eating the bones, it's drying the bones, it's affecting your body. It's affecting the inside of you when you don't praise Him, when you don't worship Him, when you don't rejoice in the Lord your God. But when you begin to get your focus off yourself and you get your focus on Jesus and you begin to be truly thankful, hallelujah. Well, how can I be thankful? I just got a bad report. Because Jesus is the answer to that bad report. Amen. Jesus is the good report. Jesus is the great physician, hallelujah. And not only that, but by you beginning to thank Him, it's like a medicine to your body. And let me tell you something, it's a whole lot better than Tylenol. Come on, somebody. A whole lot better than what man can come up with. Man can come up with medicine, but not like Jesus. Jesus says, when you begin to thank me, there's things that go off in your body. There are chemicals in your body. There's things that go on all over you, and the anointing begins to work. And this thing, man, is so much greater than anything a medicine can do. It's God's medicine. Yeah, that's right. Beginning to thank Him and praise Him and rejoice in the Lord your God. Hallelujah. When you begin to praise Him, He inhabits those praises, it says. Amen. And He gets right there in the middle of it, and He is the answer, not the problem. Amen. You're drawing in the answer to your problem. You're drawing in. Sometimes we say, where are you, Lord? Where are you? Why don't you stop saying, where are you, and just start praising Him? Amen. Because I tell you, I guarantee you, you start praising Him, you'll feel that anointing. You don't go by your feelings, but I'll tell you what, we got some. Hallelujah. People, they say, well, we go by faith, brother. We go by faith. We don't go by our feelings. Well, then why did God give us feelings? Yeah. We don't go by our feelings. We go by faith, but we get the feelings too. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory be to God. You know, there's nothing better than just get those Holy Ghost goosebumps. Some people say dove bumps. I mean, woo, yeah. God's here. God's here. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Shows up. Shows out. Hallelujah. But if you don't rejoice, it says a wounded spirit. A wounded. You know, it says a broken spirit. That's a wounded spirit. In the Hebrew, it's a wounded spirit. When you don't praise Him, you're still wounded. And it's a wounded heart. It's a wounded heart where you just feel bad. And you continue in that feeling. And you allow that feeling to direct you. Instead of saying, no, I'm going to praise God. And now you're healing that wounded heart. Hallelujah. You begin to get joyful. I talk about sacrifice of praise. I mean, you just, woo, glory to God. You just start praising Him in the midst of all that, and it will heal your heart. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Sometimes people will come up to you and say, well, what's wrong? Oh, nothing. But they can see that wounded spirit. They can see that wounded heart. They can see that there's something wrong. And there's times where you know it and you want to shake it off. Man, I wish I could just shake this off. I don't like this feeling. I'd like to shake this off, man. I'd like to shake this off. I don't feel good about this. I don't feel good. I got attacked. I got hurt. People hurt me. I want to shake it off, but I can't shake it off. And hours go by. Sometimes days go by. Sometimes months go by. Sometimes years go by. And you could have shook it off in the first 15 seconds by beginning to praise Him. Beginning to thank Him. And it just all kinds of fall. It just falls off of you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 2. Don't let a wounded spirit cause you to give up on God. Now that's when you need God the most. 1 Peter chapter 2. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. 1 Peter. 2 Peter was jealous of 1 Peter. That got him all. He finally asked for forgiveness. That was a joke. Wake up. All right. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. But you are... You got to know who you are. You got to know who you are in Christ. And you got to know the authority of the believer. You got to begin to know who you are and what you've got and what's been given to you. You are a chosen generation. Come on, somebody. You are a chosen generation. In other words, just like the Jews are a chosen people, you are a chosen people. Chosen of God. A royal priesthood. In other words, you're kings and priests. You are going forth in royalty. You are part of the royal family. You are part of the family of God. A holy nation. In other words, a separated people. A peculiar people. Well, I liked it up until then, Pastor. A peculiar people that you should show forth the praises of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. How many know it's peculiar to praise Him when everything's going wrong?
Amen.
It's peculiar to praise Him when you get a bad report. It's peculiar. You're a peculiar people that you should show forth the praises of God. You're a peculiar people. How can you praise God? You know, you're being thrown to the lions and you're praising God. How can you praise Him? Because He's the answer, not the problem. He's the one who gives us everything that we need. And our desires too, it says. Hallelujah. As long as they're God's desire. God's trying to give you something good today. He's trying to get you lined up. He's trying to say, do you know who you are? Do you know you're a king and a priest? Do you know you're chosen? Do you know who you are? If you know who you are, you will praise me. And that's peculiar. It's peculiar to the world. Because the world would rather have a pity party. The world would, they think the pity party will help them. I've seen this so many times where somebody, I'll sit there and I'll minister to them, and they'll finally get hope, and they'll finally rise up, and they'll finally feel better, and they'll get a smile, and they'll say, oh, I needed that. And in 3 seconds later, someone else walks up, and they rehearse the same problem to them. I just prayed with them. I just talked with them. They felt so much better, and they know what to do now. And then 3 seconds later, they turn around and they say, oh, what happened? Oh, I got hit in that. Oh, and I don't feel good tonight. Oh, yeah, and blah, 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 blah. And they, right, I mean, 3 seconds later. And this hadn't happened just once. This happened hundreds of times. Why? Because you can know the truth, but you can not receive it. But those that receive the truth will make them free.
Amen.
God, you know, there's something, I think we have a national holiday. It's coming up. It's called Thanksgiving. Anybody heard of it?
Yeah.
And I think because Thanksgiving is something we have had ever since we were born, we take it for granted. We think, you know, oh, I love Thanksgiving. Oh, I love Thanksgiving. What do you love about it? Oh, pumpkin pie. What else do you love about it? Oh, I love all pumpkin lattes. Yeah. Oh, what else do you love? I love all the harvest flavorings and all the, and I love this. What about Jesus? I think because we have been so ingrained in Thanksgiving that we've forgot the real emphasis and the real point. It is not Turkey Day. I hear people all the time, "Happy Turkey Day." You're the turkey, not I. I'm not the turkey. I don't receive that. Happy Turkey Day. Well, what are they doing? They're actually saying exactly what's in their heart. So let's not forget how important Thanksgiving and gratitude is. It will make you whole and complete. It honors God and it's reverence to God, but more than that, it is bringing glory to God.
Amen.
Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. That's what it's all about. It will make you whole. I remember back in Bible school, God had already used me in praying for the sick, laying hands on some people. I was young in the Lord, and I wanted to see great things. I wanted to see things like, and I was excited. This one girl comes walking down the aisle. This was at Bible school. I was a student. I'm up there in the front praying for the sick, and the professors were going back, you know, and going home. I was staying late praying for people. And this girl comes up on crutches with two crippled legs. Toes grown into every toe, crippled up legs, barely could walk down the aisle with the crutches. She came forward and I thought to myself, I hope she's coming for a headache. I can do that, glory to Him. How many know it has nothing to do with you?
Yes.
Except for availability. She comes forward and she says, I said, what do you come forward for? She goes, my legs. I said, hallelujah. I started to pray for her. I put my hands on her face and I began to pray. She fell down under the power of God, laying on the floor. I put my hands on her stinky feet. Stinky. I said, Lord, I thank you that these legs... No, I didn't say it. I didn't say that. I said, Lord, please, please heal these legs. Please heal these legs. Lord, please. Lord said, I did it 2,000 years ago. Why do I have to do it again? Please heal these legs. And I prayed and I prayed. I got up and they just twisted up like that, twisted and every toe in the other. And I got up and said, well, I said, praise God. God started something here. And I said, you know, I'm like, where's the door? I'm getting out of here. Started walking over. And the Lord said, where are you going? I said, I gave you 5 minutes. No, I was sincere. I wasn't upset. I prayed for 5 minutes. Nothing happened. He said, do you believe that her legs are already whole? I said, yes, I do. He said, why don't you pray that way? And I walked back over there. And he said, just wait. He said, you listen to me. And so I got down there and put my hands back on her feet. But this time I said, thank you, Lord. Everybody say, thank you.
Thank you.
I said, thank you, Lord, that these legs are straight. Thank you, Lord, that the toes are whole. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God, that these legs are whole. Thank you, Jesus. My whole attitude changed. And my whole life changed that moment. Because then the Lord said, mold her legs like clay. I said, what? Pardon me? He said, mold her legs like clay. I took her ankle and you could hear the bones popping and snapping as that leg came out straight. Every toe came out one by one by one. The last toe was still stuck with the other toe grown into it. I said, Jesus, it popped out. Come on, somebody. Glory to God. That changed my life. But it was when I began to thank the Lord. It was when I began to not sit there and say, please, please heal. You know, I think sometimes the Lord hears us in our prayers and says, where's the faith?
That's right.
Please. please, Lord, I'm in this situation again. Yeah, that's right. Jews call that going in circles. They get that from the children of Israel in the wilderness. But it's time to begin to thank Him to get to a place of being complete. A place where things aren't eating you up. A place where you are whole. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, Jesus, at the Last Supper, He gave thanks. Isn't that something? When He was looking at His the wine and the bread, the blood and the body, He knew what that represented. He knew that He was going to suffer. And He gave thanks. And the Lord gave thanks over the blood and the body. Why? Because He saw beyond the cross to your miracle. He saw beyond the cross to everything that would make you whole. He gave thanks. I'm going to end this morning in 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Glory be to God. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. And let's go down here to verse 14. Now thanks be to God, which always, everybody say always, causes us to triumph in Christ and makes manifest the savor, the fragrance of His knowledge by us in every place. Hallelujah. Thanks be unto God who always, say it again. Always causes us to triumph in Christ Jesus. That's why we can thank Him, because we know where He's faithful. All of His promises are yes and amen. If you don't have the promise yet, then maybe we need to thank Him.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Because it's done. We triumph. Come on. His blood gave us divine health. The cross paid it all. By His stripes you are healed. He always causes you to triumph.
Amen.
Say, thank you, Lord, for making me whole.
Thank you, Lord.
I forgive those that have sinned against me. Thank you, Lord, for your forgiveness towards me. Thank you, Lord, that you always cause me to triumph. Come on, somebody give Him praise.